I want to thank organizers for this opportunity. So we begin with an elliptic curve E defined over the field of rational numbers Q and fix an algebraic closure Q bar of Q and also an odd prime P. Further, we consider P power some points of E defined over Q bar. So this is a Galois module. The absolute Galois group of Q acts on this this group. And there is a, if you put a discrete topology on this, then this action is continuous. And we also consider a set of primes of Q and call it sigma. So sigma has this property that it contains all the, it contains the prime P and the infinite prime and the primes of bad reduction of E. So since it is going to be used throughout the talk, let me just write it. So sigma I have, and I assume that P is inside, infinity is inside, and V divide NE, where NE is the conductor of the elliptic curve. So this is going to be an even fixed throughout the talk. Further, we consider this extension Q sigma of Q, which is the maximal extension of Q unramified outside sigma. This is a Galois extension over Q. And then we have this group, fine Selmer group, which is defined by this exact sequence. So this is fine Selmer group, which appeared in the title. This consists of those cohomology, first cohomology classes in, with coefficient in EP infinity, which becomes trivial over those primes in sigma. So this is the definition. Here for a prime W, LW, denotes the completion of L at W. We'll also be, sigma also has infinite primes, but since we are assuming P is odd, H1, so P primary part of H1 LW comma EP infinity will be mostly zero for infinite prime. So that mostly we can ignore, but in sigma they are there. Yeah, so it's, so we'll see it's a sub of very small subgroup of Selmer group. And this is a kind of the smallest you can have in a sense that so we'll see in Selmer group there will be some local conditions. And here by putting local conditions to be zero in some sense, this is the smallest one. And that way I think it's called fine Selmer. Some people also call zero Selmer because often it's very small. Yeah. Greenberg denotes it by SA1. So it's like, it's like Tate-Sefrovich group, except that in Tate-Sefrovich group, here like we put EK all the points, so here we are putting EP infinity. So that was our number fields. And if we take an infinite algebraic extension, and then we take the definition by direct limit. So direct limit is over finite extensions of Q. And maps are natural restriction maps of Galois cohomology groups. So we get this fine Selmer group over even larger algebraic extensions of Q. So this was fine Selmer, and this is fine Selmer, and then we also have a usual Selmer group, which is defined using this exact sequence. So we will be interested only P primary part of Selmer group, so which is defined using this exact sequence. This is not the usual definition of Selmer group, it's slightly different. Usual definition you will see you have Selmer group E over L H1 L EP infinity and then product of H1 LW E LW bar. So this is the usual definition, but it can be shown that both are equivalent. One primes of good reduction, Tamagawa numbers are trivial, so that then both definitions are equivalent. So we will be using this definition. Calculations are much easier. Again, W varies over primes of L in that's lying over the primes in sigma, and these maps are restriction maps. And here, LW is a sub of these Galois complex groups via Kumar maps. So once we have this definition of Selmer group, you can check that there is this exact sequence. The fine Selmer is a sub of the Selmer group. And then we have this image of Kumar maps over primes dividing P. So in this talk, what we are going to do is that compare how it sits inside. In a sense, we'll see when this inclusion is non-trivial, in the sense this is a proper subgroup. That kind of comparison we will do in this talk. And then relate that with the pseudonullity conjecture, which we will, which I will explain. So
that should be delta W. The gamma W is delta.
This one? Yeah. So before we go further, let me describe few notations. So for a compact periodic Lie group G, we consider this completed group ring. So here ZP bracket G mod U is a group ring. And we take the inverse limit over natural projection maps. So we get this completed group ring, which is in fact compact. A nice thing about these completed group rings are that when G is a compact periodic Lie group, this is actually a complete Noetherian ring. And if G is a pro-P also, then it's complete Noetherian local rings. And in fact, if G has no P torsion, then it's actually a domain. So it has no zero divisors. It need not be commutative. So when G is commutative, then it's a commutative completed group ring. For example, when G is ZP, then it will be power series ring in one variable. If G is ZP to the power N, then it will be power series ring in N variable over ZP. That's the example of this kind of rings. And in fact, when all those conditions like G is pro-P periodically without P torsion, then it's actually what is called regular local ring, even in non-commutative situation, which can be defined in terms of homological algebra. So we have this. Also, these are also called Iwasawa algebra over G. So we consider this kind of groupings, and then for a module over discrete or a compact module over M lambda G, M hack will denote its Pontryagin dual. So these are the notations. We also consider these number fields. So let me write it here because we'll use it again and again. So K minus one, we have Q, then we have Q mu P, and then we have the Q mu P square, and so on. And then we call this Q mu P infinity. So we have a tower of number field. This is K minus one, K one, K2 and so on. And then we call this K infinity. Yeah, K also I call sometimes K1. Okay, this is also called K. Yeah, so we have this tower of number fields. And then inside this, we have this extension. This we will call K cyclotomic, K CYC. And the Galois group is actually isomorphic to ZP, which I denote by gamma also. This is a notation for this talk. Here, whenever this G is gamma, we denote it by the completed group ring, we denote by lambda. So these are the notations. So we will be considering fine Selmer and Selmer groups not over any extension, but what are called admissible periodic Lie extension. And what that means? And that means that, so we have this K cyclotomic, and over this we will consider some large extension, K infinity, and such that we shall assume that the Galois group of K infinity over K is pro-P periodic Lie group without P torsion. And further, we consider so that this is inside Q sigma. Okay, so here sigma could be strictly larger than this set. It can have other primes also. So this is what, and this group will be denoted by G. So that's the notation. So once we are in this situation, it turns out that if we put discrete topology on the fine Selmer group, then this completed group ring acts continuously on this fine Selmer, and its Pontryagin dual which we denote by y e over k infinity, is a finitely generated lambda g module. So, and similar thing for Selmer group. So what happens here is that one can see that this way. So we have fine Selmer group, R e over k infinity, and then we have fine Selmer group over R e over k, and there is a restriction map, and then g acts on this. You can take invariance, and one can show that kernel and co-kernel are actually co-finitely generated ZP module. And this is already, if it comes from class field theory, one can show that this is a co-finitely ZP module. So this turned out to be co-finitely ZP module. And then Nakayama, a topological version of Nakayama lemma tells that you can lift the generators. So to lift, you don't already need to assume that, you do not already need to assume that it's finitely generated in topological version. You can lift these generators to show that these are co-finitely generated lambda G module. Same thing happens for Selmer group also. So once we have these finitely generated lambda G modules, which is a Noetherian ring, we consider these X groups. So X EI of M is actually ith X cohomology group of lambda G, M comma lambda, okay, there should be a bracket here. So then we have two definitions here. So whenever zeroth X group vanishes, then we say it's a torsion module. And when zeroth and first both vanishes, then we say it's pseudonull. So here, torsion, so whenever if R, this lambda G is a commutative domain, then it's agrees anyway, you can see, easy to see. So it's kind of generalization of that definition. It's actually equivalent in commutative situation. Usual definition of torsion, if you take, then it's same as saying E naught is zero. And it's like a generalization of that definition. And for pseudonullity, so whenever G is isomorphic to ZP, that is lambda G is a power series ring in one variable, pseudonullity means that M is finite. So that's very small. If it is, say, commutative ring, if it is a power series ring in several variables, then in that case, equivalent definition would be at height one prime ideals. If you localize, that becomes zero. Commutative.
What about the higher
cohomology? That can be anything. I'm not putting any condition.
See, the point is, because this is such a nice ring, when you put all these hypotheses, the algebra behaves like a regular local ring.
So
there is a dimension here.
So these rings have finite global dimension. So after some stage, all vanishes.
Vanish, then the module becomes.
All X vanishes, then you can say zero.
The other interesting case is most, for any module, there will be all of them cannot vanish. The next best case is all of them vanish except for one. These are, you know, like pure, they are called pure. So pseudonull just means that the dimension, it's of co-dimension two. These modules will have a dimension theory. And then they will be of co-dimension at least two compared to the ring. The dimension will be at least two less than the dimension of the ring. That is the usual definition of pseudonull in the commutative case. So the same thing generalizes here. You just use a homological algebraic definition.
Yeah. So we have these definitions. So once we have this, the main object, so we consider this conjecture. And throughout this talk, we'll be actually discussing about this conjecture. So we have this conjecture 1 and 2, which I'll...
This y?
This was the dual of Fine-Selmer. Contract and dual of Fine-Selmer. So conjecture says that the Fine-Selmer over cyclotomic is extensive. In fact, the conjecture, it is over any number field, but for any number field, but I will be only considering when k is q mu p. So conjecture says that this is a finitely generated ZP module. Like in Vasava theoretic language, its mu invariant is 0. That's what it says. And second conjecture says that if you take an admissible periodically extension, then the dual Fine-Selmer is actually pseudonull lambda G module. In that sense, it's very small. So here I have said conjecture 2 is also called pseudonull, there should be hyphen. Conjecture 2 is also called pseudonullity conjecture for elliptic curves. So definition was in terms of homological algebra. but there is another equivalent definition due to Othmar. So we say that, so I have a finitely generated, let's take a finitely generated lambda G module. So I have this lambda, so I have, did I say what is lambda, what is H? Didn't say, okay, maybe. Yeah, maybe I'll write it. So we have this situation here. So I call this group will be denoted by Galois group of this is H. Okay? So I have this lambda G. And H is a sub of G. So lambda H is inside this. So if I take a lambda G module, that is also a lambda H module. So if, where it went. Yeah, so if I take an M module M over lambda G, which is also a finitely generated lambda H module, then that is pseudonal as a lambda G module, if and only if it's torsion as a lambda H module. So that's that will be very useful for us. So we basically have to now check that dual fine Selmer is torsion as a lambda H module whenever this condition satisfies that dual fine Selmer, if you can already show that it finitely generated lambda H. If you can show that, then this will happen. This lemma we can use. Okay, so. Yeah. So I should remark here that we have a finitely generated lambda H module, and I want to say that its rank is, its torsion, that is equivalent as saying that its rank is zero. So another way to say. In fact, we will be considering H, those H which are isomorphic to ZP. So in that case, lambda H is going to be power series ring in one variable, and it's much simpler then. Okay, here is another lemma due to Coates and Sujata, which says that the fine Selmer group is, dual fine Selmer is finitely generated ZP module over cyclotomic, if and only if it's finitely generated. Dual Selmer is finitely generated ZP module over cyclotomic, if and only finitely generated ZP H module over K infinity. So it's, in fact, again, this kind of control theorem argument. So you have R E over K cyclotomic, and then you have R E over K infinity, and then H act on this. And you have kernel and co-kernel, one can show that it's finitely generated ZP module. So if it is, then it shows that this is finitely generated ZP, if and only if this is finitely generated ZP, if and only if, and then again, Nakayama lemma, a topological Nakayama lemma says that it's finitely generated ZP H. So, here's another observation, which says that conjecture A, that is, dual fine Selmer is finitely generated ZP module, if and only if conjecture by Iwasawa, that mu invariant over case over cyclotomic extension of this. So we take the number field obtained by adjoining P torsion points of E, and look at the mu invariant, Iwasawa mu invariant associated to that. That is zero if and only if first conjecture is true. So there is no elliptic curve here in the second part, Iwasawa's conjecture. So it basically says that if conjecture one is true for all elliptic curves over all the number fields, then Iwasawa's conjecture is true for all number fields. That's basically
class group.
Associated class group. Sorry? So these are discrete, so I have to take the dual of this. Contrag and dual.
Domain.
Yes, rank, yeah. Okay, so we had, so basically now we need to see that when rank is zero for, okay, so one more thing I have mentioned here. So we have here, fine Selmer is inside K infinity. K infinity, fine Selmer is inside Selmer, E over K infinity. So we want to say that its rank, corank is zero, that conjecture says. Suppose that it has positive corank, then at least we should expect that rank of this is less than rank of this. So this throughout the talk, essentially, we will be looking at when that happens. Instead of really proving the conjecture, which is still open in most cases, we'll look at, so in the situation, so if you can show that under some kind of conditions, then if this has rank one, then this will be zero, and then pseudonymity will hold for that situation at least. This is what we will be looking at. I should also say that here, so there are two different kind of situations where people have studied and this conjecture and use this kind of techniques. So one is you take an elliptic curve, E, and then consider this periodic Lie extension, K, Q, E, P, infinity. So in Q, you attach all P power torsion points, coordinates of all P power torsion points of E, and then look at this Q, mu P, or Q, E, P. Then this is a pro-P, actually, in this case, if you take the cyclotomic extension here, then that will be an admissible. So this is an admissible extension of this number field. This is one situation, this has been studied extensively, and there are various examples provided by Coates, Sujata, and Ochi when this and pseudonymity conjecture is true. So one technique used by Coates and Sujata is like looking at this, whether this inequality holds. Another is by Ochi, where he considers only those elliptic curves which has only bad reduction at the prime P. And there is an isogeny defined over Q mu P. For those kind of elliptic curves, he again shows that pseudonymity is true. Basically, he shows fine Selmer is zero in those situations over this large periodic Lie extension. Another situation is, so this is the field obtained by adjoining P power torsion points of E. Another situation is you take Kummer extension, so you have Q mu P. And then here you adjoin mu p to the power n, and for some integer you join p to the power n torsion. So these roots of an integer, p power roots of integer, and p power roots of unity adjoin and take the limit over all n. So these are again admissible periodic Lie extension of this, of two dimension. And again, here there are several examples, but all the examples are in ordinary case. So we'll explain how in ordinary case this has been proved. So before I yes, cyclotomic movement. You take the class groups and take the.
K anyway contains mu.
Yes.
Contains
no, Q, K mu p will be inside this. That much you can say.
K is anyway.
This is in general. K is not the same.
Oh, this is not the same K?
No. It is true for any number field, but yeah, I have fixed K. This statement is actually true for any number field.
Okay.
I mean, this observation is actually for any number field. But once I take this extension K E bracket P, then mu P will be inside.
So instead of K, you should put any number field F.
Can you go back to conjecture 1? Is there any K there?
Yeah.
There also K is there.
This is true for I had said that this conjecture is actually for all K, but I am going to stick with, because I will be doing this Kummer extension situation, so Q mu K mu.
That conjecture K is any number.
Yeah. So now before I explain how that inequality has been proved in some cases in ordinary situation when elliptic curves have ordinary reduction at the prime P. Let me consider this set of primes. Look a little complicated, but let me explain it. It's not so complicated. So, I take, first of all, I take a subset of sigma. Call it sigma naught. So this contains all those primes away from P and infinity. So primes not dividing P and prime not dividing infinity, which are in sigma. And inside that, there are two kinds of primes. So if I take V belongs to sigma naught, then I have this local field, KV. And then I have for any prime W of K infinity, I have K infinity W. It's a union of completions at finite stages. And then there is a decomposition subgroup. G, I can call GW, which is sub of G. So G has a PI, dimension as a periodically group 2. So GW can have dimension 2 or 1. It cannot be 0 because cyclotomic extensions are inside. So it has dimension 2 or 1. So I separate those two cases and thus consider, here consider those which have dimension. Actually, it will be 2. It should be 2. And then among these, there are two kinds. Some prime, at some primes, he has split multiplicative reduction. At some, it has good reduction. So I separate these two. So first, I look at those which has actually, this is true, equals to. So first, I look at those where dimension is satisfy this. And then among them, I have at some primes, it has split multiplicative. And at some prime, it has good. Plus there are Petersen points. So I separate these two sets. Then I consider, I take the cardinality of primes over cyclotomic extension, which are in T1 and T2. So I call this small T0 and small T1. Here is an example which I just wrote down, the Kumar extension. So in the case when M is equals to P, then it's actually easy to see that one can calculate what are the primes which ramifies, and the one can actually check that T0 and T1 both are 0. Okay, so this is an example of this section. So again, let me just write down. I have Q mu P, then Q mu P infinity, and then I have K infinity, K infinity, this is equals to K, which is equals to union of Q mu p infinity and further m to the power 1 by p to the power some n. So in this situation, T0, if m equals to p, then T0 equals to T1 equals to 0. So this example we'll see later on. Okay.
H is also
ZP. Huh? H is also ZP. Yes. So I should mention in this case, H is isomorphic to ZP. In fact, so if I take any M, the primes where GW has conjugal GW has dimension as a periodically group 2 will be those which divide M away from P. So one can explicitly describe. So I also need another group. These are called Yuasawa cohomology groups. So over any number field, over any number field, I have this continuous cohomology group. So I take the Tate module associated to the elliptic curve, this inverse limit of P power torsion points of E, which has Galois action, continuous Galois action. And then I take the ith cohomology group. I take the inverse limit under co-restriction maps, and denoted by Z high, kind of standard notation. And then take the limit up to K infinity, even over K cyclotomy, over any algebraic extension. So then we have, again, this co-restriction map from K infinity to K cyclotomic, which will factor through co-invariance by H. And then co-kernel is denoted by ZE. So why do I need this extension, these groups? So for any number field, actually there is this exact sequence. So H1 Q sigma over L EP infinity, and then product of W divide B belongs to sigma H1 LW EP infinity. And then there is this, by Potter-Tate, you will get here Q sigma over L TPE dual. And after that, H2 Q sigma over L EP infinity comes. So there is this exact sequence by Pathuset duality. So if I have this exact sequence, I can take a limit and go to k cyclotomic or k infinity. And if I want to do control theorem kind of analysis, then I have to study the kernel and co-kernel of via the Hochschild spectral sequence, whatever I get. So this I can get for k cyclotomic, again here, k cyclotomic, and this is what, and it turned out that the assumption that if you know conjecture one, or if you know fine Selmer is torsion over cyclotomic, you can show that this is zero, and this is called weak Leopold conjecture, which should hold over any admissible periodically extension, in particular over cyclotomic of extension of Q mu P, we know it. So this is zero. This you can ignore most of the time. So we have exact sequence up to here. And then we have similar exact sequence for K infinity. And then if I want to study the kernel and co-kernel of corresponding restriction map, then I somehow have to also study the kernel and co-kernel here. And there JD comes. Okay? So So then there is this theorem by Coates and Sujata, which says that if Selmer group has mean variant zero, so if Selmer dual Selmer is finitely ZPH module, then the rank of corank of fine Selmer is strictly less than the corank of Selmer as a ZPH module, further minus some more things. So in this case, one can say that that inequality holds. In fact, it can be strictly less. That means that if ZE has positive corank, ZP rank, then it can be even smaller. So, and using this is in the case when E has good and ordinary reduction at P. So then only this apply. Further, this Selmer group is finitely ZPH module. In that case, we know the conjecture. And using that, one can find several examples also. One can really compute this. I'll state a lemma which will help us, which can help you, and which can be used to compute the rank of this in the situation when mean variant is, that means this is finitely ZP module. Here, I should recall, so in several different situations, this lemma has been proved by several mathematicians. In this situation of non-commutative extension, I think it has been proved by Coates and Sujata, which says that if E has good ordinary reduction at primes dividing P, then or if it is prime dividing P, then Selmer, dual Selmer is finitely generated ZP H module over periodic extension, if and only if the mean variant over cyclotomic is zero. So here is one of the criteria which using which you can check when this is finitely generated ZP H module. So here one should note down that this we can prove only when model rank is positive. So the key, I had defined in the previous slide. So this is I have this Iwasawa cohomology groups over periodically extension for k infinity and k cyclotomic. I take the co-restriction map, and the co-kernel is JD. Okay. Sorry. So. So what is the method, how one proves this? So we had, remember, we had this exact sequence, R E over K, Selmer, E over K, and then we had product of, in fact, there is only one prime, so, or maybe I should write down. In our situation, there is only one prime, and then E, KB tensor QP mod GP. Yeah. So remember from the second slide, we had this exact sequence. Fine is inside Selmer, and This is kernel of the statistics, this map up to image of Kumar map. So what they show that, what one can show is that inside this, we had EK, we have EK tensor QP mod. So if it has positive rank, this is a divisible module of corank, positive corank over this number field. And then they show that if you restrict this map here, then that's non-trivial. And using that, they get that image of this is non-trivial and divisible. And then using control theorem, they show same thing over cyclotomic extension. And that implies that the corank, and using that they can compute the difference in corank. Okay, so this is all about ordinary case and over these Kumar extensions. So just look at the, here we had, we have ZPH rank. And we have theorem is over for ordinary situation. So now suppose we want to prove the same result for super singular case. So now take an elliptic curve which has super singular reduction at the prime dividing P. Then the problem is that this Selmer group over cyclotomic extension is never finitely generated ZP module. It's never. So, and in particular also never finitely generated ZPH module over these large periodically extensions. So this kind of statement, even that doesn't make sense. This statement does not make sense in the super singular situation. Yes. So that's what we want to use. But the plus minus Selmer group has been defined so far only over cyclotomic extensions. Or even over ZP extensions, some ZP extensions or cyclotomic extensions. Or periodically extensions, we don't have.
I think Antonio may have.
Yeah, but in some cases they have tried, but
there is no
control theorem and all, it's not.
It's a small paragraph.
Yeah. So we don't have analog of these such groups for. Plus minus what you're calling plus minus Selmer group for super singular over general periodical extension. We have over ZP extensions. So we want to somehow reformulate this statement in such a way that, so we want to, instead of here looking at K infinity, we want to state it in terms of cyclotomic extension. Then I can use plus minus Selmer group. So that's what next we are going to do. So for that, so there is this formula by Hachimuri and Vanyakov. It describes the corank of Selmer group in terms of the corank over cyclotomic and plus those numbers T0 and T1. In fact, this will be zero if in this situation when M is P. Okay, so this formula we are going to use. So once we have this formula, we can just restate that theorem by Coates and Sujata. And it says that the ZPH rank of fine Selmer over K infinity is strictly less than the ZP rank of Selmer group over cyclotomic, and then these extra terms. It's same statement, there is nothing new here. But you reformulate over cyclotomic. These terms are now over cyclotomic. So that now this can be generalized to, one can generalize this to plus minus Selmer group. One can use now plus minus Selmer group. So that's what we will use. So once we have this, so now let us consider an elliptic curve E, which has good super singular reduction over at P, over Q. And we put this condition, which is like, we will be using many results of Kobayashi and Kurihara, also Pollock. And this is kind of assumption which one needs for most of those results which they have proved. So once we have this elliptic curve, there are certain subgroups of rational points of E over those local fields at P and also over global fields. And there are some technical definitions which one needs to define plus minus Selmer group. So using these, you have this to Selmer group associated to an elliptic curve with good super singular reduction at P. So one of them is called plus and another is called minus. So here we had, in the previous slide, we had these subgroups inside the group of rational points of E over, so it should be W here. Oh yeah, here is the W. So these are non-trivial only at when W divides P. At P, they are zero. So difference is only at P. So what one does is that for super singular case, Selmer groups are very large. So one wants a certain local condition which makes it somehow torsion, but still smaller, I mean torsion, but still interesting enough to have some kind of characteristic ideal. So we have this Selmer group in plus minus situation. Now we can, over cyclotomic also we have, we can take limit. So now we can try to generalize that theorem, which we had stated for good and ordinary situation. So for that, we need this result of Kobayashi, which says that the plus minus Selmer group is actually finitely generated torsion lambda module. Once we take this kind of extension, Q mu p. So even plus minus, you don't, definitions are not, so I mean, it's not very nice over general Lummer fields also. Torsion, proving torsion and all these. One can always define those sets. But if it is giving a nice Selmer group or not, that is not very clear. So that's why this Q mu p is kind of important. So once we have this, that plus minus Selmer group of torsion, we can have lambda invariant, mu invariant. We can talk about whether it is finitely generated P or not. So then we have this theorem, a direct generalization of the theorem in the ordinary case, which says that the fine Selmer group has corank strictly less than the plus minus corank. So actually we don't need this to be finitely generated ZP module. One can go modulo P primary part and then that will be finitely generated ZP module. And we have this, one can still have this theorem. So I'm even not putting here Selmer group is finitely generated ZP module. I'm just putting this is finitely generated ZP module. Fine Selmer is finitely generated, dual fine Selmer is finitely generated ZP module. Same thing holds in even in ordinary situation. No, there is no y plus minus. In fact, local condition is nothing, it's all zero there. So
when you put plus minus here, so this rank is less whether you take plus or minus.
So it depends on, so we have this condition, no? This e plus minus is infinite. So if e plus kn is infinite, then you put here plus. If e minus is infinite, then you put here minus. So its statement is, there are two statements here. Okay. Yeah, so once, I mean, one need to check that. See, if one can show that if model rank is positive, then one of them will have rank positive, either E plus or E minus, because they will generate the whole group. Then one of them will have positive rank, and then, so for that plus or minus, corresponding plus and minus, this theorem will work. So just one of them need to be, have positive rank. Yeah, so key results is again in the similarly, I mean, ordinary situation. We need to show that E plus minus, so we have this map from E plus minus Kn tensor with QP mod GP to E plus minus Kn V for every prime V dividing P. So here in the ordinary case, we had this injection EK tensor QP mod GP inside Selmer group, or over any n, we had this injection. If we want to replace it by plus or minus, then one need to prove it that there is an injection. This is proved by Kobayashi. So for that, they need this property that EK bracket P is zero. Not just K, in fact, KB is zero for all B dividing P. For super single elliptic curve over Q mu P, and this is true, they have proved it. And using that, we have this injection. You have this injection for global, and also we have injection E plus minus KN V inside tensor with UP mod GP inside H1 KN V. EP infinity. So these two injections had been proved by them under conditions that under this, first they proved this, there's no Peterson points defined over Q mu P, and then using that they saw this injection. So we have this theorem. So once we have this injection, we can apply same trick that inside Selmer group we have a divisible subgroup, we restrict the map there, and so that it's non-trivial. And then you use control theorem. Yeah. We also need this theorem by Coates and Sujata to restate it in terms of over cyclotomic extension. So there, in the ordinary case, whenever we could compute rank, whenever rank is positive, then we could say that Fine-Selmer and Selmer has corank strictly. So Fine-Selmer has corank strictly less than the Selmer group. And to compute the corank over cyclotomic extension, you need to compute lambda invariant of Selmer groups. In ordinary case, we have periodic L function. Using that, one can compute analytic lambda invariant. If you know main conjecture, you can compute the algebraic lambda invariants also. In this situation, we have plus minus periodic L function. So one can again compute the lambda invariant. And in CM situation, we know main conjecture due to Pollock. So there are many examples where one can really compute algebraic plus minus lambda invariant also. So we could find many examples. Two of them are here. There are many more. Even in non-CM case, there is one-side divisibility, and using that, one can still compute in some situations. So that, so once we have this has positive rank for one, either plus or minus, again the rank is going to be, again one can say that plus minus Selmer group has rank is strictly more than Fine-Selmer over number field, and then you use control theorem to say it over periodically extension. So. Yeah, this is an elliptic curve with conductor 1600, and this is 361. So basically, I had to compute over Q mu p, which was slightly complicated. We have to compute for all tachymular twists. For one twist, it's implemented in Sage. For other, it's slightly complicated. It's not for ordinary case; it is implemented, but non-ordinary, it's still not. I don't know now recent, but sometime back when I did, it was not implemented. So it was a little complicated, but one can still. The situation I was in, I could show that another one has value periodic unit, so that actually vanishes. And so twist had periodical function vanish, and then we have this example. Yeah, so I finished it a little bit early.
Okay. Are there any questions or comments?
Yes, for these examples.
For those examples, otherwise it's a conjecture.
Yes.
What was the CM field in those?
No, in that case, main conjecture is for plus minus, it has been proved by Pollock. So I could compute algebraic lambda invariant by computing the analytic lambda invariant. Otherwise, if you don't know main conjecture, I don't know how to compute the lambda invariant of Selmer group.
The lambda invariant?
No, this ZP rank over ZP rank of, so I want to compute, so if I want to compute X plus minus E over K cyclotomic, ZP rank of this, I need to compute the lambda invariant of this. So, no, so I could, so the situation I was in, I could show that the lambda invariant, I had, in those examples, a lambda invariant of this was one, and the model, plus minus model rank was also one. I think one was plus. Those two examples had plus model rank was positive, and the plus lambda invariant was positive, so not minus. So then I could use that theorem to say that the Fine-Selmer, this rank, corank, so rank of lambda H, but is strictly less than this minus something, and T naught and T1 was 0 because I had taken M to be P. So minus something, but this is 1, so it has to be 0, and that, yeah, super singular. So there were no examples known before in the super singular situation, because all the examples known were using comparing with Selmer group, and that we could do only in ordinary situation before. Because in super singular they were not finitely generated, but plus minus works once you reduce the statement, once you reformulate in terms of cyclotomic extension. So this is strictly less than that much is only, one can, so.
Infinite is arbitrary.
Yeah, I have worked with expressions which are like, I had this assumption that they're Galois group of K infinity over K was two dimensional. Okay. I have done all these things for that. But still question is for general also. I think it's possible due to some extensions, some cases, but there are some small technical complications.
What happens if you take K infinity with some very specific
That is also one can, I have not, this I could, there are some technical things which I could work out, but.
Use the fact that K infinity arises from something very specific to.
What the main problem no, is, I could. Is then once your K infinity, like you attach P division points, then the group becomes large, it's dimension 4, the reality. So then higher homology groups and homology.
Yeah, that is also there.
And I have no idea how to compute that.
And also this. These things about plus minus Selmer group I have used, which has been only done, I mean, people know it only over like Q, Q, mu, P. For plus minus, things are not so nice over general. So once I take Q, all P power torsion points, of, if I attach to a field, then Q, mu, P. So this is, so in particular, K infinity will be periodically over, say over, I have elliptic over Q, then periodically will be admissible over this. So there are P torsion points. And then those injectivity, certain things which I explained, even the definition of plus minus Selmer group over these, whether they are torsion or not, these things are not clear. So that is why I put the, but question still makes sense. And
see, of course, I mean, the most natural thing would be to take curves with CM, you know, CM in the But even in that case, you don't have, I mean, you have examples.
These false state extensions.
These are the false state extensions.
These are the false state extensions.
It also works for.
But you work in the best case scenario.
This also works for ZP2 extensions. I have taken any two dimensional periodic extension which satisfies that.
So even there you have numerical examples where the connector is in. But even in the CM case where everything is commutative, you don't have to do the hard work, even there you don't have a general proof for. Again, you have plenty of numerical evidence. You take a CM elliptic curve, then over the field that you get after attaching field, you know that the Selmer group has mu invariant. You can define the analog of a mu invariant even there. You know that the mu invariant is mu. And in all known numerical examples, in just such cases, the mu invariant is also zero over the cyclotomic extension for the Selmer group. But there's no general theoretical proof why this happens.